Have you ever wanted to fist fight an alien, sucker punch a Xeno, or maybe even Texas Chili Bowl ET? Well, if you have, then I've got great news. In the movie Signs, aliens visit Earth, and more specifically, a small family in Pennsylvania. While broadcasting their inevitable attack, they begin sending out reconnaissance teams to learn about the species located on Earth and how they operate. After learning about the anxiety-ridden hairless apes, they go on to launch an invasion of the planet that appears to be massively unsuccessful. So in today's episode, we will discuss why their idea failed due to biological limitations, as well as the other theories of what the aliens may be. Also, bear in mind, as I wrote this, I pretty much have COVID, and I also have COVID while I'm recording it, which isn't as fun as it sounds. But I swear, if I'm lying, I'm dying. It makes you so scattered brain, it's not even funny. So writing this was fun. So with that disclaimer set, let's see what's more effective at writing, Roanoke biology or a virus. So as per usual, y'all know the drill. Up on screen, there'll be a timestamp where you can bypass the summary of Signs. For all those who have either seen it or don't want it spoiled, I'll probably just end up spoiling it later when we talk about everything wrong with the aliens, so I guess, you know, I would advise you probably just watch the summary. Plus, the watch time helps get the video out there. For all those still sticking around, let's get to why humanity will never step foot on Venus without a massively reinforced suit, because we have the ability to quasi-think ahead. We open up our story to a former Reverend Graham Hess. As he walks around his house, eventually he ends up hearing a scream outside. Going outside, he quickly meets with his brother Merrill as they take off into the cornfield to find the kids. Running through, they first meet up with Bo. Grabbing her and then moving forward into the corn, they run into this creepy little kid named Morgan. This kid still freaks me out when I was a kid, and he freaks me out as an adult. Anyhow, Morgan has stumbled across something in the cornfield with his dogs. As the camera pans out, it shows that all the corn has been laid in a pattern, while the dogs continue barking at unseen things around them. A further pan out reveals that this is very obviously a crop circle formation that is outside of their house. Assuming it to be a prank, Graham begins making his calls. He thinks it's Lionel and his Wolfington brother friends, but he's told that they were at the movies and there's really nothing that they could have done. Back inside, the dogs are beginning to act a little strangely themselves. The male dog, known as Houdini, urinates in the kitchen as if he's afraid of something around them like a predator. As Morgan grills out, Bo attempts to give Houdini some water but mentions how the water is contaminated. She moves Houdini's water bowl closer to the dog, which instantly starts the dog growling at it. Showing signs of aggression, Morgan tells Bo not to move. Back out at the cornfield, Graham and the officer are inspecting the corn as she assumes it was just some joke. Graham gets up realizing that he hasn't hurt his kids in a while, and then exits the field to find Morgan had to stab the dog after it went after Bo. Graham collects his kids and then heads inside angry at Merrill for not stepping in and is instructed to tie Isabel up and make sure the knot is tight. Later that night, Bo wakes up her dad remarking that there's a monster outside of her window and she wants a glass of water. Graham goes in and begins talking to her before catching a glimpse out the window and someone is standing on the roof. Graham wakes Merrill, who's downstairs, as they decide it must be the Wolfington brothers. Merrill decides cornering them is the best option as they both run around the opposite sides of the house and seeing the shadow of what they are chasing. They meet back up around the other side of the house to discover the creature jumped over 12 to 15 feet straight up in the air and gotten back onto the roof. As they stand there, behind them the corn rustles and they hear a thud as whatever they were chasing just jumped through the cover of night and back into the field. Graham calls the officer again the next day and chastises Bo for leaving water cups all over the house as she continues to say that the water is tainted with something. The brothers both talk to the officer about what happened the night before, but she is reluctant to believe it was one of the Wolfington brothers, or even that it really happened the way that they were remembering. She mentions all the weird stuff going on and that they need to head into town to clear their minds, get some pizza, and relax to get the family back on a good footing with reality. As she does, Bo says the same show is on every station. Apparently all over the world, crop circles have begun showing up at alarming rates. Nobody is sure where they're coming from or if it's just a coordinated event, attributing it to one of the most elaborate hoaxes ever to have been pulled, or that it might actually be real. Everyone is stumped as to what's causing all of these symbols to appear at once. Heading into town, Graham decides that that's really enough of the radio and TV for the day, and then he goes to the pharmacy while everyone splits up, with Merrill heading towards the recruitment office and Morgan and Bo heading towards the bookstore. Morgan is trying to get a book on extraterrestrials to learn more about what may be happening. Graham ends up basically being a reverend on wheels for the girl behind the counter as she is freaked out by what's happening, and Merrill reads over some material from the recruiter. As he is looking at a board, the recruiter mentions that he's got it all figured out, says that whatever or whoever is doing this has been sent out on reconnaissance as a team to investigate the area. They've been sticking to the shadows in an effort to not be caught, and none have actually been seen in the light. He goes on to mention how the military does this exact operation when clearing the way for the rest of the invasion force. And here, we get some backstory on Merrill. Holding the minor league home run record, apparently he knows how to swing a bat and also swing away. Back at the bookstore, Bo continues to say something is wrong with the water despite nothing really being wrong with it. They all meet back up and eat some pizza, but while they do, Graham spots Ray Reddy, or M. Night Shyamalan. Pretty sure I pronounced that correctly. Anyways, the man who ended up taking out Graham's wife, leading to him losing his faith and then leaving the church. Eventually, they all head back home for the day. Arriving home, the baby monitor Morgan has begins going off. Graham is hesitant to believe that anything is happening with it, or really that it might just be picking up another baby monitor. Which, you know, in farmland, with no other buildings around, for miles. As they get out of the car, the baby monitor is indeed picking something up. The higher up they move, they are able to get a signal in order, and eventually they hear clicking. Two somethings are talking to one another, and then the signal cuts out. Later that night, Graham heads outside to feed Isabel, and as she continues to bark at the cornfield, he too starts looking in the cornfield. But assuming it to be nothing or just a person out there, he grabs his flashlight and heads into the cornfield to look for what is distressing Isabel. As he moves through, he can hear something in the cornfield with him, but doesn't see anything. Eventually, in his ear, he hears the same clicking noise from the baby monitor, which freaks him out. He then drops his flashlight before picking back up and smacking it to get it working again. In front of him, he sees an inhuman leg disappear into the field, and then he takes off running. Now, when I say this part as a kid almost made me crap my pants, dude, this was absolutely horrifying back in the day. Getting back inside, Graham sits down while the rest of the family continues doing whatever it is that they were doing. Eventually, they notice and ask what happened. He agrees that they need to basically turn on the TV now and see what's going on. As they all watch, lights have begun appearing in the sky all over the planet. Specifically in Mexico City, lights have appeared, and both the US and Mexico confirm that it's not from them. Morgan begins taping over Meryl's swimsuit special VHS, total bummer man, and as they watch, they are completely entranced by what the lights could mean. Meryl is understandably freaked out and attempts to seek comfort in his brother, but I gotta tell you, man, I got two brothers, and when have brothers ever been comforting? Meryl says he believes those lights to be a miracle, and that can only mean something good. Graham says that he knows that they are on their own if those lights are bad, and nobody is coming to help them. As they continue talking, Graham mentions how his wife, as she was expiring, started saying things for him to see signs and for Meryl to swing away. That the last firing of the neurons in her brain were of them at a baseball game. So yeah, he seems pretty jaded. The next day, Graham wakes up to find that Meryl has taken the TV into the coat closet because the kids were getting obsessed. He mentions how the lights have gone, but a bird flew into something in the sky and then smashed its skull in. So whatever is there is still actually there, it's just camouflaged. Upstairs, maybe the kids are getting actually a little obsessed. They have made tinfoil hats to wear as they read from Dr. Bimbu's book about the extraterrestrials. Essentially, they fall into two groups, just like people. Either they are here to peacefully expand their knowledge of the universe, or they are here to invade and take over the planet. As Graham flips through the book, they eventually spot a picture that looks like their house with two small figures drawn on the lawn, and one larger figure next to them with the house on fire. After taking the book away, Graham gets a phone call from Ray. Sensing something is wrong, as he would never call him, he heads to the house to talk to him. Getting to the house, he looks in a window and finds signs of a possible struggle. He turns to find Ray sitting in the driveway. He begins talking to him as he mentions how he fell asleep that night and he lives with that guilt. How it was almost destined for him to run into his wife. Nobody was around, and at that exact second, he falls asleep. He apologizes for what happened, and he also mentions that he trapped one of the things in the pantry not to let it out. He then says that he's heading to the lake as they do not seem to like water, and then floors it out of there. Back in the broom closet, we finally get a look at these things. As Meryl sleeps, a news report comes on. On Child's birthday, the kids are freaking out and pointing at something. Looking into a bush line, they can't really see anything. Then around the other side of the house, there's a small entrance or alleyway. They're looking through and spot one of the creatures walk across the path. Completely green, the creatures appear to be able to camouflage. They freeze frame the creature in an almost Bigfoot esque scene, and it kind of looks hilarious. Back at Ray's house, Graham approaches the pantry. He begins talking to the creature after seeing its shadow, saying that he's the police and he's got all of his friends loaded up in the paddy wagon, and that he will offer them the same deal he gave to his friends. With no response from it whatsoever, Graham attempts to look and then sees nothing. Grabbing a knife, he then slides it under the door and sees a hand with some claws that come out for his eyes. He cuts off two of the fingers of the creature, and him and it both scream. Graham quickly leaves and then finds that his family are all wearing tinfoil hats. At this point, everyone believes that they are under attack. Meryl says that they can camouflage, and that's why they couldn't see him at night. Graham asks Morgan what would happen if the aliens were hostile. He mentions that they wouldn't use their technology in the invasion, as they knew man would turn to their ultimate answer, nuclear options, and this would render the planet useless. So they would attack, and if defeated, they would come back hundreds, if not thousands of years later, and then re-attack, at which point humanity would probably be ready. The other option is that they win. So are you seeing this reoccurring allegory with dual outcomes? Anyhow, Graham says because Ray seems to think that they don't like water and that they could go to the lake, or they could stay here, and he really just puts it up to a vote. Graham and Bo both vote to go to the lake. Meryl and Morgan vote to stay at home. Ultimately, however, they decide to stay at home and then board up the house. As Meryl comes outside, he ends up throwing a rock into the cornfield, and as he does, the creatures are actually in there, which who knows? Maybe that was seen as a sign of aggression. Honestly, bro, just set fire to the whole field. That would be my game plan. Later that night, as they all continue to watch the TV, more lights begin amassing over cities, 274 cities to be exact, and they expect roughly 400 cities to have these lights. How they came up with this figure? Not exactly sure. They remark how they are coordinating, though, with the maps and the fields. That means they are literally going to be coming down right outside of the doors. The planet is gearing up for an invasion, with the military being mobilized and ready to rock. As night draws in, they essentially have their last meal together. However, nobody really eats after Graham freaks out. They have boarded up everything, but nobody really expects this to work. Graham yells about how they won't be praying over food and it's wasting time, and as they hug it out, the baby monitor starts clicking to life. They check the TV to find that all signals are no longer being broadcast and it has begun. They nail up the last of the boards and get ready, eventually just turning to sectioning off entire portions of the house. However, outside, they forgot to put Isabel into the garage, as she is the first to go by the aliens. Pretty rough, man. As they can hear the creatures moving around the house, the only thing I could think about was, how does a farmer not own any type of handheld? I mean, I guess he's a reverend, but come on, man. Even paladins and crusaders have a sword. As the aliens attempt to break in through the doors and test out the strength of the enclosed areas, the aliens eventually move up onto the roof before breaking into the windows of the upstairs bedrooms. However, the doors have been boarded shut, but then they begin to realize that they made a crucial error. They forgot to board up the attic door, leaving them completely exposed once they did get there. Looking at the front door, an alien hand comes through as it attempts to open it. Moving down to the basement, they then shut the door and brace it. Almost immediately, though, the aliens are on the other side and trying to force it open. Morgan remarks how the aliens will read their minds and they forgot their tinfoil hats, and then they'll learn how to open doors, and just as he does, the creature begins to open the door. Meryl and Graham brace the door before accidentally knocking the light out. As they sit there, they begin to realize that the creature is just making noise and not actually trying to get in. They remember that a coal chute used to be used where they poured it into the basement and then begin looking for the entrance. As they find it, Morgan is standing there, and a hand from the coal chute grabs him, and they're able to pull him away, but it triggers an asthma attack. Graham is able to calm Morgan down enough from his asthma attack, but not easily. And eventually, they all fall asleep for about 12 hours as the invasion continues. Then we finally see what happened to Graham's wife. Ray ran into her with a car, pinning her in the process, and if they move the car, she would expire quicker. The next morning, they get a radio signal, and the aliens are apparently leaving. They were able to use poisonous gas in small amounts to end a lot of people the night before. However, three cities in the Middle East were able to find primitive methods of getting rid of them, and ultimately, that caused the invasion to fail. The aliens did, however, leave a ton of wounded behind, and there's no way to know if the invasion over them is completely over or not. Morgan is in dire straits, though, so they turn on the baby monitor, hear nothing, and have to assume that the invasion is over and head up. Meryl goes up first and then confirms that everything appears to be okay. The house is a complete wreck, however. The aliens have broken through the windows, and Bo reports that people are dancing on the TV, having survived the invasion, which prompts Graham to go and get the TV so that Morgan can watch while he gets his medicine. As he wheels it back in, he sees in the reflection that they aren't alone. One of the aliens has picked Morgan up in a threatening manner and has his wrist up to his face. Meryl attempts to move, but is stopped. Graham recognizes that the alien is the one whose fingers have been cut off. The alien is showing the international, or I guess intergalactic symbol, for aggression, and then faces off with the two brothers. They all stand there completely unsure of how to actually proceed. But I assure you, caveman brain will proceed anyhow. We flash back to Graham's wife. She uses her final words to tell Graham to see, and for Meryl to swing away, which then clicks with Graham. Facing the alien, Graham then tells Meryl to swing away. Meryl picks up the bat on the wall, which causes the alien to poison Morgan. However, as Bo screams, Meryl attacks the alien with the bat, which causes him to drop Morgan. And then, we get some good old-fashioned low-tech human-on-alien violence. You love to see it. The alien gets knocked over as water is then dropped onto him, which burns his shoulders, revealing a massive weakness. Graham runs outside as Meryl continues to beat the absolute hell out of the alien with water and glass. Graham is able to revive his son as Meryl knocks the alien down, and as it falls into a table, it pours water over its face and shoulders, suffocating it by what I could only assume is complete face meltage. Out on the lawn, Graham puts together the pieces of why his son had asthma, and why his daughter left water everywhere. But concerning his son, because of the asthma and inflammation, the poison wasn't able to get in the lungs of Morgan, and he survives. And then we move into winter. The alien invasion has failed. Graham goes back to the church after forgiving God, and everything is about back to normal, except for likely millions of people lost due to the invasion, and the inevitable one that will follow in the future if humanity doesn't become technologically powerful enough to stop them. Time for signs 2, Electric Boogaloo. Now, the first first thing we must talk about, and really the most obvious of all things that happens here, out of all the planets in the solar system, and out of all the systems in the cluster, and out of all the clusters in the supercluster, and out of all the superclusters in the galaxy, why in the name of all that is holy would Earth be chosen? It's pretty easy to meme on, seeing as aliens are like, ah ha ha, you're allergic to water, you big dummy, but is it really that? Now, I am not an astronomer by any stretch of the imagination, however, I did take a bunch of college courses back in the day on it. My goal still today is to try to eventually get to be an astronaut. Biology was actually sort of a possible route I could have used to get there. Now, the state of the planet right now and the fact that I'm getting older is making that seem more and more like a non-possibility, but with that said, I do know a few things about planets. The Earth is somewhat special, we're finding out. We are in a zone known as the Goldilocks zone. Not too hot, not too cold. Actually, technically speaking, we are on the warmer side of the Goldilocks zone, and things could have actually been more habitable if Earth was just a little farther back. In fact, just a little fun side fact for you, they think Venus may have been habitable as early as 700 million years ago. So the Goldilocks zone moves out, and in fact, I believe in a billion years, Earth is gonna no longer be habitable because of the amount of sunlight we'll be receiving. Anyhow, as the sun continues to use up its hydrogen fuel, it turns to fusion of heavier elements, which will expand the sun out, pushing this zone further out past Mars, which is also interesting because then you start getting to Saturn's moon Titan, as it's theorized that this is actually a moon that resembles Earth very early in its formation. So it may become habitable after a few million years in the later stages of the sun's life. Regardless, as we look out into the galaxy, we find usually gas giants around parent stars or super Earths with high gravity, and really what we don't find are Earth-like planets as far as we know them. Now, even by sheer probability, there likely are Earth-like planets out there, but honestly, at the beginning stages of our solar system, a dance between Jupiter and Saturn was required for the inner terrestrial planets not to be eaten up by the gas giants or flung from the solar system, or even just the creation of a super Earth which couldn't have supported life. To convey how lucky it is that Earth even exists isn't possible in the course of this video, but on an astronomical scale, so many things had to happen to allow Earth to be capable of supporting life, it almost seems intentional. Philosophical statements aside, the fact is, so far we haven't found anything that would indicate another planet is completely Earth-like. We have found some terrestrial worlds that are in the Goldilocks zone, but it's impossible to know from this distance, apart from analyzing the atmosphere and what sort of light is returned, known as emission spectrum lines, we can't really get an idea of what that planet is like, but we can get an idea of what the atmosphere may be composed of. So as for motive, why choose Earth? Well, considering these aliens seemingly breathe a similar atmosphere of mainly nitrogen and oxygen, and can at least tolerate the other gases much like we do, Earth would seem pretty habitable. And considering we as a species haven't really stumbled across another Earth-like planet, the idea may be that it's extremely rare, and even a spacefaring species such as the ones from Signs may not have come across any. But then we come to the biggest question that everyone brings up. How could a species be so stupid and so smart as to literally go to a planet that is 70% water with water vapor in the air where it rains all the time and attack a species mainly made of water and not even bring something like a suit or technology or anything to aid them besides hand-to-hand combat? Well, this may be easily explained and look no further than human behavior. So what are humans trying to do right this minute? If you answer get off this rock as fast as possible, you're correct. Humanity right now, despite knowing that we really haven't figured out shielding from the solar particles of the sun, which we know punches holes in our DNA. In fact, astronauts have been quoted as saying they can literally see the damage in their eyes. When the particles from the sun would be launched into their bodies, it would occasionally go through their skull and strike their retinas, causing flashes of light. When looked at, the particles are literally turning people into Swiss cheese on a microscopic level. Anyhow, apart from this happening, humans still want to set up shop on a planet completely hostile to us, Mars. We can't breathe the air. If we were left exposed on its surface, we would perish in minutes. And we aren't even sure if we can grow food there or if there's usable water for us. Essentially, despite the world being completely alien to us and no way are we adapted to it, we still want to set up a foothold there and possibly work on terraforming it. And I believe that's the key here. If humanity found a planet with a mostly oxygen and nitrogen atmosphere that had some sulfur in the air, or possibly, you know, it would occasionally acid rain, and this could melt you if you were, say, like caught out in the open, I thoroughly believe humanity would still go for it and worry about terraforming it later. The aliens and Signs, I believe, are doing the same thing. With a possible motive nailed down as to why they would even show up here in the first place, we also need to talk about the biology that we have seen in these creatures and how possibly they may not actually be as susceptible to moisture as we think they are. Getting a good look at these things, which is hard due to the fact that they are pretty much keeping in the shadows the whole time, they stand at roughly about, I would say, 6'7" to 7 feet tall, or about 2.5 4.5 meters. They are humanoid in structuring with two legs and two arms. Their head sits directly over their shoulders, which is how our own species is structured, and having the spine hold up the skull led us to be more intelligent, so the same can be assumed for them. Starting with their feet, it's going to be hard to get a good look as it happens quickly, but they appear to have three toes and one toe further up near where a dew claw on a mammal would be. Now, it could be a dew claw, like on mammals, but more likely, this would indicate that this species originally had a prehensile foot like humans had back in the day. However, over time, rather than walking like humans started to walk, they instead continued to climb and walk. We can actually see this style of walking is supported by when the alien crosses the alley at the kid's party. The way it slightly hunches forward and moves suggests it looks like kind of an early ancestor of humans than walking like, say, humans would walk. This would place this creature walking on the balls of its feet rather than the flat of its feet like humans do, which is called plantigrade structuring, which I've said probably millions of times over the course of this channel. The legs are long and lanky with greenish skin, and the skin appears to be quite thick, likely thicker than that of what humans have, but they are still quite susceptible to injuries. Overall, moving up to their upper body, they appear to be somewhat lanky continuing on, but they have had a lot of the same muscle grouping of humans, albeit longer and likely larger, judging by their size. Their arms are pretty skinny, but within their forearms exists a tube. This tube can be pushed outside of the body to excrete a small amount of poison gas into the lungs of humans and cause them to suffocate, resulting in their end, and the end of a lot of people on the planet. However, it would appear that it does have its limits, and quickly dissipates should the lungs be closed. In fact, during Morgan's asthma attack, this is seen. However, with the same attack, it's entirely possible this in reality just causes people to experience an extreme form of anaphylaxis, which is why Morgan's medicine containing anti-inflammatory medicine was able to rout the alien toxin. On their hands, much like on their feet, likely, they have three fingers and one thumb, and claws about an inch in length, which can be used for attacking. The head of this creature is a little larger than a human's, which, as we know, relative to body size, can translate into huge gains concerning intellect. With the cerebrum much larger than that of humans, the signs aliens are incredibly smart. I know it may not seem like it due to their choices of where and how they began to attack, but consider the terraforming idea, which we will go into momentarily, because first, we have to talk about the absolute crux of the issue, susceptibility to water, which we will go over in a second. Their heads are fairly smooth, with no hair at all, making them appear more reptilian. There are no ears on the sides of their head, and instead just have holes, which indicates that they can actually hear. They also possess large black eyes, typical to the human lore on aliens, and a smaller jaw and mouth that seems to have teeth that I would say appear to be that of omnivores, although it is mentioned that the aliens would have adapted a vegetarian lifestyle, which is also seen in Ray's house that an alien was eating vegetables. Being a being made of cells, though, how much do you know about them? Well, hopefully a lot, but ask yourself, what stops, say, us from dissolving completely when you drink water? Well, apart from evolving on this planet, the main thing is control of osmosis. Movement of water is really what it all comes down to. And if you think about it, that and salt really control everything. Placing a cell in a hypertonic solution, or the cell having less salts than its surroundings, the cell would shrivel as water is drawn out. Placing that same cell in a hypotonic solution would cause the cell to actually swell as water rushes into it, and this could ultimately end up bursting it. In fact, looking at your body, the only reason you're not as influenced by water in the surrounding area is because of your skin and its waterproof abilities. Or, at minimum, water resistant. If you've ever seen the palms of your hand, they absolutely do absorb water when they've been in them long enough. But concerning cells, what helps mediate all of this? While not being 100% effective, this is known as the phospholipid bilayer, or the cellular membrane. This membrane is composed of two parts. The outside is hydrophilic, which means that it loves water, and the interior is hydrophobic, which means that it hates water. This essentially creates an inside area and an outside area of the cell. Without membranes, we'd really be nothing but just floating amino acids, and in no way could do anything because we wouldn't be anything. So don't forget to thank your fatty chains. So this is native to a species from a planet that is mostly water. Without this, life as we know it could never have been. And this is what I believe is specifically happening with the aliens from signs, but only to specific points in their bodies. Taking a look at the damage from the alien when water was knocked onto it, it almost seemed to cause burns to the skin. And when enough was dumped on its face, it appears to have gone into shock and stopped breathing. Now ask yourself, if there is water vapor in the air, why didn't this happen when it was breathing? To answer this question, we have to look at its skin. The first thing we see in this creature is that it is adept at camouflage. Much like how the octopus is able able to alter its pigmentation and blend in with its surroundings, so too are the aliens. This adaptation is known as having chromatophores. Down to a microscopic level, tiny muscles can pull on a cell, opening and closing certain areas to reveal sacs of pigments. Depending on how much it's opened or closed, this can change the coloring of the pigment and thus create camouflage. Now, that's really the quick and dirty version, but essentially, this opening of this sac is what I believe is the issue for these aliens. As the creature is covered with these specialized cells, they may not be located in every single cell of the body, and instead may have a phospholipid bilayer much like humans have concerning their normal unspecialized cells. However, the cells on their body, specifically the skin due to this pigmentation sac, may actually either have a weaker resistance to moisture, possibly due to a more hydrophilic layer covering the sacs. With the introduction of enough water though, this overwhelms the natural ability of the cells to move water out of itself, and this quickly causes them to burst. And this is why these burns appear all over the body when water touches them. Atmospheric presence of water isn't enough to overwhelm these cells, however, but submerging them, pouring water on them, or even rain could overwhelm the skin's ability to remove the water, causing these cells to burst on contact. Once this happens, it opens up the body to a whole host of issues. Imagine it like a person who has severe burns from fire. Having those can send a person quickly into shock where they stop breathing. Much like the alien that we see when water was poured over its head and shoulders, it's too much for its anatomy, which would explain the rapid shallow breathing that we saw it doing before it finally stopped. It's not that the water was burning its insides, it's just that it was set into shock quickly, say like a human who suffered severe burns, and this led to its end. I believe the aliens, based on their actions on this planet, were able to breathe the same air as us, even with the water vapor, but due to the specific cells that make up their skin, this could lead to their end should they come into contact with enough water. Rounding back to the terraforming idea, this may be why we see these certain aliens on the planet versus others. As made mention in the book by Dr. Bimbu, they wouldn't use their technology when attacking the planet. Instead, they would engage in hand-to-hand combat with humanity so that we didn't use our nuclear options, which would render the planet useless. Because of this, the sacrificing of some of their species rather than the whole planet would seem like the best option, which in turn brings us to one of the theories in the movie. This theory is possibly pretty viable, and it's that the aliens were sent to attack, but they weren't the actual species pulling the string. Instead, they were just prisoners. Using this fodder species to invade a planet and attempt to overwhelm the natives there may have seemed like the best option. However, sort of like one man's trash is another man's treasure, except one alien's ultimate badass is humanity's casual annoyance, may apply here. Potentially, whatever the controlling species is may view what they dropped on Earth as the ultimate weapon, but really, it was nothing more than just another animal to be overcome by humanity. First, we have our military might. We have weapons at our disposal that we can put lead downrange and interrupt the chemical reactions of life for these creatures fairly easily. It may be that the original species was not accustomed to war quite like humans were and relied on hand-to-hand, and when dealing with a species that they dropped on Earth, considering they had poison gas, this seemed like a crazy advantage. So not only was the invading species expendable to the real invading species, but they also seemed stronger, which you'd think a species would actually learn about humans' violent history before launching an invasion like that, and to their credit, they kind of did because they knew about our nukes. However, even with our apes together strong mentality, many would still succumb to these aliens. It is mentioned how three cities in the Middle East were able to find primitive ways of combating the aliens, and as a result, they were able to drive them out. And this brings us to our other theory on these aliens, and that is that they aren't really aliens at all. The idea of demons has been floated, and after the debacle that was my video of a wreck, I know better than just to completely ignore this possibility, mainly because of all the rees I got in my comments, but the idea is pretty clearly based on what we have seen with a reverend losing his faith because of the death of his wife, holy water affecting demons because it was in the reverend's house, and Graham struggling with his own demon that seemingly follows him until he finally has to confront it with the help of Meryl and a baseball bat. And even then, there's allegories all throughout the actual movie that have more of a religious tone rather than an invading alien tone, I guess. But honestly, to me, yeah, this is definitely a possibility considering, you know, first it's a movie, but let's just say for a moment that the biology of this creature does seem to fall in line with an actual possibility of a real life creature, whereas a demon invasion of Earth would require, in my mind, more than just dumping water on them, which presumably is what the rest of humanity did and then drove them off the planet. Besides, I'm pretty sure the Doomslayer has already got the market cornered concerning demon invasions. Overall, I believe this to be not so much a demon, but an alien with very specific biology, possibly hailing from a desert planet. They do know humans would likely burn everything down to deny them the planet, a very human-esque thing to do. This requires these clicking aliens to react more in a way that causes them to be restrained when invading Earth. However, their adaptation civilizations were never really meant for this planet. As a result, the things that exist on this planet, like human beings on other planets that we were never really adapted to, makes it difficult to survive and turns out to be their weakness due to the hydrophilic nature of their skin, which may have been known to them, but again, just like humanity, when has a hostile environment ever stopped us from exploring something like space?